So actually, some people raised the question about my affiliation. So I'm in the Department of Computational Science and Engineering. Actually, I'm a mathematician, not an engineer. So I was in the Department of Mathematics, and I moved to this department by some actually reason. But I'm doing some mathematics. I'm still doing mathematics. So. Actually, I graduated from here, so Christ, 12 years ago, so I'm very happy to be here. I remember this room, so, but it's kind of, there's a lot of change here. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about today is a global estimate for Green's matrices of second order Elliptic systems. Let me do some quick reviews on the Green's form here, and so on. So, Green's function is okay, so you have a domain, and this is actually kind of just set up actually, just awesome, very nice thing. Assume that this is a bounded domain with a nice boundary. And then we say that the Green's gxy is a Green's function for Laplacian if this one, this is y is a pole, you take the Laplacian in the first the variable, you get delta function, and the g vanishes on the boundary. So it's so this function was introduced by Green, and he actually gave the simple physical proof of the existence of this Green's function, which says like S is a perfectly conducting shell closed vacuum, and S is grounded so that potential becomes zero, and you just put the unit charge inside of this omega, then this will induce the potential. So physically, yeah, this is a very nice thing, but mathematically, the proof of this required actually some years. Anyway, just let me use a further review. So now just think about the domain is not nice, but it's just omega is just arbitrary open set. Then this is a weak formulation of the Green's function. So we say that this is Green function. First of all, this is you can talk about the weak differentiation, and this is integrable locally. And then this is a direct delta function in the sense of this weak sense. Then also we want to say that the g vanishes of the boundary, and this is the condition that zeta is a function which is identically one near the pole, and this is completely supportive. So one minus zeta, it's like it is just one near the boundary, and it kills the singularity here. And we assume this belong to this space called y1 to 0. And then y1 to 0 is, in short, actually, if your omega is actually had finite volume, it's just a standard space, w1 to 0, so subject space with a zero trace. And or just it has a finite width. Also, we have the same thing. If omega is a large set, then it's a really different. First of all, this you can see this is a sublife exponent, right? So if n is bigger than or equal to 3, then we assume actually this assign this now, the gradient L2 and this sublife exponent to U. And this it has some kind of homogeneity property. And then just n equal 2 is a little bit different because you can see that when n equal 2, this you can change this to L infinity now. But you have to define this thing. So gradient U is in R2, and if you multiply this, any complex support set in R2, not omega, this has a vanishing on the boundary, something like that. So then it's well known that actually that if when n is bigger than or equal to 3, then the Green's function Rn is that exists, and this has this nice actually this specific representation, right? And then, because of Green's function doesn't exist in R2, so of course there's a fundamental solution of the Laplace equation, but it changes sign, so it's not considered a Green's function. So in the classical potential theory, so this is a quotation I just obtained from the book by Duke, and they said that every non-empty open set is a Greenian domain, which supports Green's function, and not too large of empty open set. For example, every non-empty bounded set has a Green's function, and so on. So theory is a little bit different when n is equal to 2 and n is bigger than equal to 3. So then this is, let me move to this uniformly elliptic operator in the divergence form. And we assume that we actually put a very minimal actual assumption here. So you have just ellipticity assumption here. And I don't assume this is symmetric, so you have all the bound units. And this is single mu plays the role of the ellipticity concept. And then this is the definition of the Green's function. We say that this is Lg is delta y, and this is vanishing on the boundary in this sense. And then so on. So, and the transport operator is defined by this. Because Aij is not symmetric, so this is different, but it has satisfied the same assumption anyway. This is a non-zero for the Green's function for uniform elliptic equations. So, Littmann, Stamfatia, and Weinberger, it's a long time ago. And they assumed that L is a symmetric operator, and omega is a bounded domain, and then there exists a unique Green's function, and it also satisfies the symmetry. And later, when N is a non-symmetric operator, so if the L is not equal to Lk, so the first result was obtained by Wood and Wiedemann. It's also a long time ago. And they only consider n is bigger than equal to 3. And that's basically because the theory of the subject embedding at the, the exponent. And there is, of course, there's also Green function. And if you change the role of x and y, then it is Green function of the transport operator. Okay? And it has this nice bound and so on. And if you read every paper by those people, and models Hahn inequality and the maximum principle of average using the proof. Okay? So, also in n equal 2, so let me actually recite as some result from the Green function and fundamental solution. These papers, same papers, this gap with n equal 2. Construct the Green function in the bounded domain for symmetric operator. They already have with the symmetric operator. And Koenig and waving me, so he's supposed to be here, but he didn't come back. They construct here actually fundamental solution. This is not the Green function, but the fundamental solution is constructible in our case for symmetric operators. And Chanida and Yan and Li, they prove that this is. So they proved that actually this is this actually solution is actually BMO in our view. Yes. I think Yan and Li is sitting there, yes. Okay, so let me actually move to the system. And the Sloane elliptic system is I'm talking about the it's similar to the it's a vectorial version of the elliptic equation. So you have vector, m vectors, these column vectors, and it operates acts like this. This is a matrix, and this is a column vector, it's a matrix multiplication, and so on. So this is another geometry column vector. And then we assume here the strong elasticity is so called actually, this is this form is bounded above by this mu times c squared. For C, and also bounded by actually this one. So this mu actually, singly actually gives a elliptic constant and the boundedness here. And you can see, if you write this system point-wise, then you can get this thing. This is point-wise expression. And transport operator is, it's not a little more complicated because this is a matrix. You just change the beta and alpha, and also have to take the transport matrix. So it's a transport operator. So symmetric system is when this is equal to A alpha beta. So that means you can change the I and J and the alpha and beta. So. Okay, so then let me define the Green's matrix for the Sloane elliptic system. So it's a similar. So first of all, this is W1 on local. So if you fix the Y, this is placed, this is the pole. And then this is now becomes a direct delta function at y with multiplied by this identity matrix. in the sense that in the, this weak sense. Okay? So, of course, the, because I'm assuming this makes sense. And also, this is belong to that space y1 to 0, which is a completion of C0, C infinite, compared to its opposite function in that y1 to none. So that actually, which this, again, that's, this means that basically this is, has a zero phase on the boundary, and so this belongs to this space. So it's if you just move away from pole, actually this is a kind of square, like the gradient is a kind of square sum of, yeah. All right, and then this thing, the last one is, it says about this green function is kind of inverse of this operator. And if you write this way, f is any kind of a bounded function with complex support in omega, then this belongs to this, and this is by this equation. So this, I put this thing to ensure the uniqueness. Okay? So if you have this function, then the uniqueness will be of the Green's function followed automatically. Okay. So then this is a non-result, previous non-result for the Green matrix. Martin Fox, it's 1986. He considered actually bounded the C1 domain, so bounded domain with the C1 boundary. And then this is the continuous of the boundary. Then exists a unique Green matrix, and it has this symmetry. And this one is the Green matrix of the transpose operator. This result was actually kind of improved by Dorsman and Mueller. This result was he didn't for actually he proved the existence of Green's matrix, but this bound was not obtained. He assumed that further that this reporter continues to get this one, but Dorsman and Mueller proved this thing. Also proved the existence of Green's matrix in the bounded rigid domain in omega is in the two-dimensional domain. Also boundary difference and logarithmic bound. Okay? So basically what you can see is those are actually we are assuming that this is so continuous, then this theory is a kind of perturbation theory for constant coefficient, basically. And this is different from the work of this Littmann, Stampach, and Weinberg, and so on. Let me actually explain actually my previous work with other people. So this is a unified approach in studying Green's function and matrix. So this is just notation. Dx is the distance from x to the boundary, and this is just a standard notation minimum. So I just have condition IH. This means an interior Hodel continuity assumption. So there exists actually Hodel exponent. Mu is a Hodel exponent here. And this is a kind of critical radius. So this may go to open infinity. And this is N0. So that if this is a weak solution of either this equation of the transpose equation equals 0 in this the ball, where this R is less than this. So actually this is interior in the interior form, really, because you cannot go outside of the distance. Yes. Then you set was actually this relation. So this relation may look actually strange if you haven't seen this, but it's a standard just a Morris space thing. And this is equivalent, you can prove this is equivalent to this order actually continuity estimate. Okay? So, then, okay, that was, this is theorem by Hoffman and myself. We are actually studying something, a layer potential, and I explain this layer. Anyway, just this is theorem. So this is the domain in the, this is not, could be any domain, really, any open set. And assuming the condition INC, which is a Hodel continuity assumption, then there exists the Green's matrix, unique Green's matrix, and then it satisfies this bound. So here we have interior actually, just this bound is valid if this is, it cannot escape to the boundary really, you think C is. And the C depends on here, just n, dimension number equation and ellipticity constant here, and the Hodel exponent mu and this n0, which appears in the condition IH. So then this is generated by actually n equal 3 is, you can need to actually use some different approach here, n equal 3 and n equal 2. So n equal 2 result was obtained later. This is joint work by the Hong Jie Dong. Omega is either ball domain with a finite volume or finite width. Okay, so then actually what you need is some kind of Bangai inequality. So then there exists a unique Prince matrix such that it has this logarithmic bound. Okay, so gamma is either the minimum of the volume or the width squared. And then if this is also this is the interior estimate of the so it's not global estimate. So why I'm calling this a unified approach in studying Prince function matrix, because it covers both the actually scalar theory and the vectorial theory. So if n per one actually is just this is a scalar case, then by the celebrated result by the Jodi, you know that the further continuity estimate is satisfied with the exponent, which is at this number, which depends on the onion dimension and it is constant. And the RC is infinity. Okay? So, you just kind of, you have a scalar invariant estimate up to infinity. And two dimensional, actually, this is not the two dimensional, yes, this is number we created in two dimension and any elliptic system. So, it's related by the Charles Murray Jr. And this is said that this is satisfied with this view, which depends on this now, this constant now, n equal 2. So it depends only on 2, but it's n equal 2 fixed now. And n0 depends on actually number of equation and this constant, and r is also infinity. Okay, so when n equal 2, or just a single equation, you have this nice theory. And then, okay, just for the system case, and n is different, bigger than 3, then there are actually several cases where we can apply this theory of the theorems. Either it's just this uniformly continuous or the VMO. VMO is, anyway, this is a perturbation of constant coefficient in the epsilon. Then this interior quadrant continuity is satisfied. Now, this sum actually number, so RC now it cannot be go to infinity, this is less than infinity, depending on the modulus of continuity, or the modulus of the VMO modulus of continuity. Okay, so this, and then, actually this is why we studied this theorem by Steve Hoffman. We needed actually some, we were developing a layer potential technique for solving at the boundary problem for the elliptic equation, which is a complex elliptic equation. Which, then the, which actually kind of surprisingly, there was a kind of no known result for the estimate of Green's function. So that's why we studied this. So if this is small energy perturbation of this diagonal, this thing, so this is a diagonal system. If you have a system which is uncoupled, then you have actually m single equations. So you have the George estimate, and this is the perturbation. Then the small perturbation, then the further continuity is preserved still. So you have this thing, and again, this RC is infinity, so that's important. Then, okay, let me now explain the global estimate of Green's matrix. So this is our the main talk. This is joint work with the Peng Gang. Just let me explain the notation here. So this is the first, this is localized the omega with the intersection with the ball, and this is the boundary omega intersection with the ball. Okay, then let me introduce the LB. So this is the local boundary this condition. So there exists a certain actually mesh radius which may go to infinity, and so that the n0 which is positive such that if I is less than this maximum, and then if this is actually W1 weak solution of either this one, L equal F, or this transpose equal F in this domain, so here, where this is the bounded function, also assume that the U equals 0 on this boundary intersection with this ball, okay? Then for all p within this range, n over 2 and infinity, you have this estimate. This is a condition of LB. So we assume this, then we get some result. And I'm going to come back to this condition later. For example, you can see in the scalar case, this is automatically satisfied by the theory. Actually, you can just, it's a subsolution theory. So models actually, theory actually use this. Okay, then this is the theorem, first the theorem. So if that the local bounded assumption is kind of ceiling, the depth percentage is satisfied by the pair, then you have, I have to assume that n equal bigger than equal to 3. So then the g, this bounded by uniform bound here, if this is x minus y is less than r max over 2, if this is infinity, then you have global bound, and so on. So then the theorem B is actually converse of this. So this assume IH. So, and if the GX is the Green's matrix, then and suppose you have this thing. This G of XY had this bound. Okay, for XY within actually zero, the satisfying this assumption, okay, this relation. Then the local bounding is satisfied, okay. So you can see that local bounding is assumption and this global bounding is if and only if condition. Of course, it is more than one thing. Okay, so. And then, okay, this we go a little bit further, and the condition LH, this is the local further continuity assumption. It's the same as just the interior further continuous assumption, except one thing. Now, U is a solution, U L equal 0, or L equal the homogeneous equation, satisfying U equal 0 on the portion of the boundary. So let me actually, maybe it's better to draw, to help you. So it's your domain. So then this is the ball. This omega R is this region, and this is the sigma R. Okay. Then, okay, we assume this LH. So that is that means that basically this is, if you use vanishing there, then it's harder continuous of the boundary here. Okay, so it's the same thing really. Then if you have this, then you have, if this is the Green's matrix, then any x and y is satisfying this relation, we have this thing. So what this means is if distance is kind of away, then this is dominating. If this is smaller, then you have actually better decay at the boundary, near the boundary. And if you are actually, this is kind of large, then you have just a regular entry bound. Okay? Here C is the constant depends on the number equation and dimension, and this thing appears here. It is constant, and mu zero here, and n one here. So which is the constant which comes from the condition LH? Okay, it doesn't depend on R max. And if this is finite, suppose this is finite, and if omega is bounded, then you can get this bound for x and y, actually. And of course, you have to change the C by this, depending on this one. So this boundary, this R max divided by time. So, okay, so let me actually explain the application of this. Scalar case, you can know actually the local bounded condition, the interior holder continuity is satisfied with this thing. Actually, this R max is infinity and N0 now depends on the number of dimension and this one, which is constant. And then LH, the condition, local holder continuity is satisfied. If you need to put some assumption on the domain, of course, because that's a global kind of just a holder continuous up to holder continuity of the boundary. So this is a variable condition which is called, usually called the condition S. That means that if you fix the ball, this x is on the boundary, and if you fix the ball, and outside of actually this domain, so you have, you can find actually the measure comes over here. So for example, just the uniform exterior pump condition implies the S. Okay, so if you have reached the domain, then this is satisfied. then correlate it here. So in the scalar case, and any domain, so then this function L satisfies this bound. Of course, this is a random thing. You can actually use this thing by using maximum principle, right? So the thing is, this is obtained from the our main theorem. And this is also useful because the domain could be unbounded. So, and if you play with unbounded domain, then you have to be a little bit careful of the maximum principle. But you don't need to worry about this kind of thing if you define response like that. And so, and also probably this is also one-dimensional thing. And then the Green's function here. And if the domain satisfies the condition S. And the RA is here, so RA appears in the condition S, so that this may go to infinity in some cases. So then Green's function is set by this bound now, and C depends only on the this there should be no m here, so dimension m equal 1, and the elliptic constant and theta, which C appears in the condition S. Okay. And if this RA is finite and omega is bounded, then you have this global bound. You just get rid of this condition RA over 2 in the expense of making C, depending on the derivative also. And then, so this is actually an example of if you have a half plane, then the condition S is automatically set by the theta equal 1 half and RA equal infinity. You can really check this. So that other color implies this one. So Green's function is bounded by this. And there's no actually restriction on x and y. Okay. So what you need is actually this kind of thing for the polarization of a single equation. So then the second application is, of course, L-infinite polarization of diagonal system. So diagonal system means you have a single equation, and you have n copies of single equator, and then you just perturb it like this way. Okay, so it's kind of it's related. This is become the system, but it's a small perturbation. Then the L is the condition, and assume that the formula satisfies the condition S, which is a kind of exterior matter condition in some sense. And if it's then there exists epsilon zero, which is depending on here. So if this is small, if it don't exceed this threshold, then you have LH is satisfied with this principle private constant, and R max is RA, which is in appears in the condition S. So corollary is here. So if you have XY satisfying this thing, RA, then we have this matrix bound here. So it has a, it is better if you are near to the boundary. Okay, the same statement here. And the example is, for example, if you have a domain, unbounded actually, the domain above the Lipschitz graph. Okay, so then you can see that the omega satisfies the condition S, so bounded the exterior matter condition with theta depending on the Lipschitz character, and the RA here is infinity. So you have the Green's matrix bound here. So, and this is uniform, really, for all XY above this domain. Okay. So in particular, if you have a flat portion, then you have a similar thing. Then systems with VMO coefficient. So if it's a variable thing, VMO is about vanishing mean oscillation space. And if a function is in VMO and if it's bounded to C1, so domain, then you can check it's a variable thing. The local Hilbert continuity is satisfied by this depends on also VMO modulus. Okay, so. So for example, uniformly continuous function is also in VMO, and this VMO includes every some more. And then this is a corollary. So if omega is bound the C1 domain, and assume the coefficients of the operator belong to VMO, then you have this bound, and then C depends on here everything, and then also modules continue with the principal copy. So, and you have to also this C1. And actually, if you assume that if you have the VMO coefficients, then you may allow to add lower terms. Actually, this is the lower terms here, and the lambda is here. So, and then those are actually got the matrix, so which is bounded, okay? And it's suffered the Legendre automatic condition. It's weaker than strong elliptic condition. We assume this, and this is also cloudy. And each you have to assume the bound the C1 domain, and then this the principal coefficient is belong to VMO. Then okay, you have to put some restriction here. Just the lambda should be somewhat large to make this system coercive, really. So then the and also you want to have a partial quality equality quality. So then the Gris matrix exists. And satisfy this relation. Okay, and everything you have to do here. Okay. And you can also apply this to the some special case, stationary stock systems. And this is one rich domain, or just above domain above the rich graph. And it's known that the law of this is satisfied. I think that Dr. Chang sitting here is known about this, right? So, and this is also covered. Of course, it's, this is figured because we assume in the proof, we started with a strong elliptic system, but when you have this kind of stock system with a constant coefficient, and if you this is a three-dimensional thing, then it basically gets a work of Zhou Chen, so who studied this three-dimensional stock system. He first proved this is a bounded thing, and the LV is satisfied, and the LH is also satisfied. So then you have this condition. Then we have to mention a little bit about because this extension to parabolic system. So you can have the parabolic system, okay? So strongly parabolic system is like this. You have this thing, strong parabolicity. It's a very typo, FTX, okay. And the transpose operator is defined like this, with the negative sign and so on. Then the Gris matrix is this one actually. This you apply this operator, parabolic operator, you get the delta function, and this vanishes on the we are assuming on the cylindrical domain, on the kind of the later side of cylindrical domain. Okay. And this condition, the second condition, will be far from actually first and third really. This is more actually known actually thing about the fundamental solution, right? So actually this T opposed to S, then it acts like a delta function on the kind of initial condition, right? So parabolic burden of IH is here. So same thing, and the weak solution, you have to be very careful about what weak solution here is. And this is weak solution defined by the Lagrangian, okay? And then this kind of condition is satisfied. And then was the theorem by so-and-so and Hong Jiazhong and myself. And we had this theorem. It's a parabolic version of this. It's a parabolic version of elliptic meter. And this one is the parabolic distance. Okay. And this result is also useful. So if in a domain, two-dimensional domain, and you think of feature Hickman, so then you have this one. So you don't need to assume anything here. Just if it's a strong elliptic operator, then you have this Fisher Hilkner is time independent. So you have the condition, the local border condition is satisfied. And then those kind of things, this solves this problem. L equal F, if you just do this thing. And then also this solves the quotient problem. If you have this GY is now just a function in L2 omega, and if you evolve things from here like this, and this is a weak solution, unique weak solution of the quotient problem, and this boundary varies, actually the initial value is determined if this continues at this point. Okay, and this is another theorem. When actually Now you have the Alice's bound, so this is, if you have a fundamental solution matrix, then you have this bound. Now, what you have to be careful here is the gamma here is something here. Gamma is up here. If you don't have gamma, then you have the Alice's bound, right? So if RC is actually infinity, so in the case, in the for example, in the scalar case, RC is infinity, and the several cases, RC could be infinity, then this term drops out, and you have a user Alice bound. And otherwise, you have some kind of effect here. So this term grows. Okay. And it has a reproducing actually formula and so on. This is actually interior estimation. So we are actually we actually obtained the result in the Elliptic, and just this parabolic extension of this theorem is, I think this is also immediate. So we are preparing that result, but it's not it's still work in progress. That's it. So if you are interested in the single proof, then I can show you. Actually, everything is a kind of geology argument, so it's good.